هدوء. صباح الخير للجميع. الصوت اصلا مش كثير واضح، فلو سمحتوا بدون احاديث جانبيه عشان نعرف نسمع ونفهم. اوكي، first of all I will introduce myself. دكتور رعد دويس، assistant professor, general surgeon and coloproctology surgery. Or before we start, today we will talk about history, physical examination, and investigation regarding the abdomen and mostly the GI, the gastrointestinal tract. So we will focus on the abdomen, the abdominal cavity. Now what we will discuss today is very, very important. We will keep repeating same things, especially in the major of general surgery this year and in the sixth year. So if you get the concept now, if you understand now, you will save time later. يعني ما في مفر. إذا ما فهمنا الآن بدنا نرد نرجع نعيد بعدين. فخلينا الآن نفهم ونركز لأنه كله رح يتكرر معانا. Okay, we will start by the GIT history. Now the commonest complaint in the abdomen, let's say, is the abdominal pain. It is not enough just to say the patient has abdominal pain. We need to follow it with many, many other details. Now, to understand how to analyze abdominal pain, first we need to know the types of abdominal pain or how it originates. الكل سامع واضح الصوت كويس. We have two main types of abdominal pain: visceral and somatic. The visceral pain differs how? Visceral pain is triggered by distension of a hollow organ. شو يعني hollow organ? Like what? Like small bowel, for example. Distension of small bowel or any hollow organ will trigger this visceral pain. Also, traction on the mesentery or excessive smooth muscle contraction of the wall of the hollow organ. Usually the visceral pain is poorly localized. How? The patient comes to you, you ask him to localize the pain. Where is the pain exactly? Point to the pain. He will say, well, doctor, it's here in this area or in the whole tummy, the whole abdomen, or let's say in the right side of the abdomen. He cannot put his finger and localize the pain. Okay? This pain is conducted by a special nerve fibers, the sympathetic splanchnic nerves. Now the somatic pain is different. Why? The somatic pain is caused by irritation of the nerve endings in the parietal peritoneum. In the parietal peritoneum, as we know, we have the visceral peritoneum, okay, covering the internal organs, and the parietal peritoneum lining the peritoneal cavity. The somatic pain is lateralized. What do we mean by lateralized? Usually the pain is in one site, right, left, up, down. The more you go to the periphery of the abdomen, the more likely the pain is somatic. The more you go to the center, the more likely the pain is visceral. Okay, it is localized to the area of inflammation. يعني وين ما في inflammatory process فوقيها على طول بيكون في somatic pain. بينما ال visceral pain it differs. Maybe I have a pathology. For example, I have appendicitis, but the pain, you know, the appendix is in the right iliac fossa, but its visceral pain is periembolical or central. So the pain is in the visceral pain. It is not necessary for the pain to be exactly above the inflamed or the diseased organ. But the somatic pain, no, it is exactly. Okay, now the visceral pain, we can classify it according to the site mainly into pain arising from the foregut. شو يعني foregut? Foregut is lower esophagus, stomach, duodenum until the second part of the duodenum, plus everything that joins this part, like liver, gallbladder, biliary system, pancreas. All these things, their visceral pain is in the epigastric region or upper midline, epigastric region. The midgut from the second part of the duodenum until half of the transverse colon or the proximal two-thirds, all this part is called the midgut. The visceral pain, again, مش somatic, the visceral pain of the midgut is usually felt in the center of the abdomen, periumbilical region. The hindgut, which is the distal third of the transverse colon until the dentate line, which is the midway of the anal canal, any pathology in this region, its visceral pain, again, not somatic, its visceral pain is felt as suprapubic pain. في ناس بسموه hypogastric. لو سمعتوا hypogastric هو نفسه ال suprapubic pain. Okay. Also, when talking about the abdomen, we should remember that many other organs outside the abdomen, their pain is felt sometimes in the abdomen. Like what? Like the genitalia, the testicles. A pathology in the testis is felt as a pain in the lower abdomen. Okay? And other gynecological disorders also. Okay. So we described first the pain, whether it is visceral with its characteristics or somatic with its characteristics. حكينا الفيسيرال poorly localized. The patient cannot localize it well. The pain is not necessarily over the diseased organ. ممكن يكون مكان ثاني. Somatic, لا, somatic more localized over the diseased organ. Okay, now the onset. Sudden onset, gradual onset. It's very important to mention this. Why? Sudden onset means the problem happened suddenly. زي ايش مثلا? Perforation, hollow viscus. يعني مثلا perforated duodenal ulcer. واحد عنده duodenal ulcer. صار لها perforation. At the exact time, بصير في spillage of the gastric juice or the enteric contents. بتروح على ال peritoneal cavity بتعمل له irritation. This happens within seconds to minutes, not over hours. So, يعني أشبه لكم إياها. واحد مع أصحابه بيحكوا بضحكوا قاعدين في كافيه. فجأة بيحكوا مع أصحابه بطل يرد حط إيده على بطنه هيك مالك severe pain sudden onset. بينما الـ gradual onset واحد قاعد مع أصحابه عنده mild colicky pain. مالك في إشي؟ لا لا ولا إشي بغصة خفيفة. كمل معاهم طولت القعدة ساعة ساعتين ثلاث. The pain increased in severity. Okay, he tries maybe to have some herbal preparations, to take some analgesia, but he will not directly go to the hospital. While the sudden onset pain, نفس القعدة الشباب مالك تعبان sudden onset pain بياخذوه على المستشفى. Gradual onset pain usually after several hours until he seeks medical attention. Okay. طيب, sudden onset pain, what are the causes of sudden onset pain? Hollow viscous perforation, as we said, ruptured of abdominal aortic aneurysm, يعني something ruptured, perforated, something happens within seconds. Mesenteric infarction, also ischemia causes sudden onset pain. Now, some inflammatory processes like acute pancreatitis, although it is an inflammation, and the inflammation usually builds up gradually, but it is more towards the sudden onset than the gradual onset. يعني this is an exception, acute pancreatitis, maybe because it's caused by chemical irritation rather than infection. So, in summary, gradual onset pain, على طول منفكر بinflammatory process. شو الinflammatory process؟ كل اللي بنتهي بitis, cholecystitis, appendicitis, diverticulitis, whatever. Okay. Now, the character of the pain. يعني we tell the patient, describe how it feels like. I know it is pain. Whether it is stabbing, زي الطعن, whether it's constricting pain, إشي بشد هيك, whether it's colicky pain. Colicky means بالعربي شو؟ المغص. Now, most people, if not all, they experienced in at least once in their life this colicky pain. So almost everybody understands what do we mean by colicky pain. Now, colicky pain means there is an obstruction and contraction proximal to it trying to overcome the obstruction. For example, I have intestinal obstruction. So the bowel proximal to it tries to propel the contents to overcome this obstruction. فبصير عندي forceful contractions. Okay. Also, biliary pain and renal pain. Now, renal pain is a colic. ما بتشوفوا اللي معاه حتى بيسموه مغص كلوي. شو بصير؟ Episodes of pain comes on and off, comes for a few minutes and then leaves. يعني نشرحها بطريقة تانية. المريض بيصيبه نوبة الألم دقيقة دقيقتين بعدين بيهدى الألم. تحكي معاه وانت بتحكي معاه فجأة بسكت تيجي another attack of pain. 1 minute, 2 minutes, then it goes away for another 1 or 2 minutes. This on and off cycle is very characteristic of colicky pain. يعني إذا المريض ما حكى لي أنا عندي مغص, إذا ما فهم علي بسأله بطريقة ثانية. Is it on and off? Does it come and go? The radiation of pain. Radiation of pain means the pain extends or spreads to another place which is not involved in the pathology. شو يعني؟ مثلا radiation of pain peptic ulcer disease, acute pancreatitis, whatever, starts as epigastric pain والمريض بيحكي لك الوجع بلف على ظهري. Okay, so it is radiated to the back, or it originates in the back and radiates to the epigastric region. Okay, it depends on which one is more severe. أو مثلا acute cholecystitis, the pain is in the right upper quadrant. رح نحكي طبعا في الexamination شو يعني right upper quadrant, and it radiates to the back. Okay, it radiates to the epigastric region. So it's the spreading of pain to another place, but in continuity. يعني continuous line, the pain runs in continuous line, spreads. بس في إشي تاني اسمه referred pain. Referred pain means there is pain here and pain in another point. Between them there is no pain. There is a gap. Like what? The best example is, actually we have two examples. In acute cholecystitis, the pain is in the right upper quadrant, and the patient tells you also, I have pain on the tip of my right shoulder. Type between them, the chest wall, no pain. So this is called referred pain. Referred pain, okay? مش radiation. Radiation is continuous. لو المريض حكى لي the pain is continuous from right upper quadrant the right side of the chest for example and it reaches my right shoulder, okay, this is radiation. Referred pain, no. Pain in one site, pain in another site away from the pathology, and there is a gap between them. Another example, the acute appendicitis. Acute appendicitis, the patient may feel pain peri-umbilical and pain in the right iliac fossa. Usually, after some time, the pain in the peri-umbilical region disappears and only the right iliac fossa pain stays. But in some time, both of them are present there. And between them, there is no pain, there is a gap. So we can consider it part or one type of the radiation of pain or referred pain. Okay. When we discuss the pain, we shouldn't forget that we have other symptoms. Okay, we analyzed the pain, the onset, the nature, the type of pain, the progression, everything. Now we ask about other associated symptoms, and we ask about aggravating or exacerbating factors of this pain, what increases this pain, and what decreases it. Other commonly associated symptoms in the abdomen, anorexia. Anorexia means loss of appetite. We will discuss it later. Nausea, vomiting. These things are very common, but they are non-specific. So vomiting can be caused by a very long list of pathologies. Okay, there is a good example after perforation. When I have a perforation, I will have sudden onset pain. Typically, this pain is resolved for some time. And then after like 1 hour or a period of time, it comes again. The first pain is caused by the perforation itself and the direct irritation. Then it subsides. Later on, the other attack of pain is because of the inflammatory process that follows this perforation. If the pain is exacerbated by movement or by cough, why? Coughing moves the abdominal cavity. So the inflamed organ will touch the parietal peritoneum and cause irritation. While, for example, the renal colic is not relieved or is not aggravated by movement. يعني المريض will try, will roll in bed, will jump, will stand. يعني تطلع على المريض اللي عنده renal colic بيمشي في الغرفة, بينام على السرير, بيتحرك, بيحاول ياخذ وضعية معينة to relieve the pain. No benefit. بينما المريض اللي عنده مثلا peritonitis. Okay, عنده perforated appendix, whatever. He lies still. Usually, the patient will lie supine and not move even his respiratory muscles, will have shallow breathing, or will lie on his left side or right side, lateral decubitus position, with some flexion of the hips. Why he flexes the hips? لما نعمل flexion للhips, منبعد الabdominal wall عن الinflamed organ. Okay? Flexion, partial flexion of the hips will move the abdominal wall with its parietal peritoneum, which is sensitive to the pain, بيبعدوا عن the inflamed organ. So it relieves the pain partially. The severity of the abdominal pain is something subjective. يعني, for the same pathology, exact same pathology, two persons may react differently. One person may shout and yell. The other one will just tolerate the pain and will tell you, oh no, I'm okay, there is some problem. So it's something very subjective. حاول انه يخلوها something that can be measured objectively. شو عملوا؟ صرنا نسأل المرضى, what is the most severe pain that you have ever experienced in your life? If she was a female and delivered already, ممكن تحكي the pain of delivery. Okay? أو tooth extraction or any dental procedure, the toothache is the worst pain that I have ever experienced. So you ask the patient, okay, if this is the worst pain, your current pain, how much it is considered to compare to that one? يعني لو هذاك 10 هذا قديش منه؟ نصه تقريبا 5 6 4 8 زيه 10. So it is like a way to trying to make it more objective, something that can be measured. Pain cannot be measured. There is no machine or a tool or instrument that can measure the pain correctly, accurately. It's something very subjective, okay? But we try to make it objective by measuring it on a scale from 0 to 10. 10 is the worst pain that you have ever experienced. Okay, I know when you see such tables you get confused, but if you read it, it really helps you. It summarizes a lot of things that we have mentioned already. Let's see. It gives us common examples like peptic ulcer disease. The typical site is epigastric region or epigastrium. Onset, gradual. Character gnawing. بس تسمعوا كلمة gnawing pain اللي هي النغزات. Gnawing. And it is really gnawing. Like pricking of pins. So in the exam when I say gnawing pain, I expect you to think of peptic ulcer disease. لما أحكي throbbing pain, I expect you to understand that I'm talking about an abscess. So this term is very important. And in the exams, we always bring you the typical description. يعني في keyword. لما أحكي لك مريض عنده throbbing anal pain. What is, طبعا long history. What is the differential diagnosis? Anal fissure, thrombosed external hemorrhoid, perianal abscess. I expect you to be smart enough to understand that it is an abscess. Why? Because I mentioned the word throbbing pain in the history. يعني هاي keyword. بس تسمع throbbing pain تروح على choices اللي فيها abscess هي الصحيحة. Okay? Gnawing pain معناته الدكتور قصده عن البيبتيك ألسر. Okay, another example, let's say acute pancreatitis. Character, constant pain, radiation into the back. These are the typical things. So please try to memorize it. Most of the patients that you will see, you will encounter in your life, will have similar presentation. Rarely you will have atypical presentation. Okay, as we have said, anorexia is the loss of appetite or lack in the interest of food. But we should be very careful. Sometimes the patient avoids eating not because he has poor appetite, because food will trigger pain. Okay? The patient will tell you, I haven't eaten anything since yesterday for the last 24 hours. على طول بروح بستنتج he has loss of appetite, anorexia. No, wait. Why haven't you eaten anything? Because whenever I eat, I feel pain. So I avoid eating in order to avoid pain. Is this loss of appetite? No. Or maybe he thinks that the food will trigger the pain. Maybe it's not true, but he thinks, he avoids eating because he thinks that it triggers pain. Or if it really triggers pain. So we should understand why he doesn't eat. Okay, if I tell you now you are fine, you can eat, I'm the doctor, and I will bring you a type of food that you will really like. Will you eat? He said, okay, if you tell me that it will not cause pain, actually I'm hungry, I wouldn't mind to eat. This is not loss of appetite. But if you bring the patient the best food that he likes, and he tells you, no, I can't even think of it. This is true loss of appetite. Okay. Why we have anorexia? Common causes. Dieting, being on a diet, loss of appetite or malabsorption, malnutrition, reduced energy intake, energy loss, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus due to marked glycosuria, so the patient will lose glucose in his urine. Okay, now about weight loss. Whenever we encounter a patient with weight loss, we should know if it is intended, intentional, or unintentional. شو يعني؟ بسأل المريض. Did your weight change? Yes, I lost weight. Okay, عنده weight loss. So I start thinking maybe it's malignancy, maybe it's chronic disease, maybe malabsorption, maybe something like that. No, wait. Why do you think, I ask the patient again, why do you think you have loss of weight? Okay, I'm on a diet. Okay, so this is intentional. This is intentional. It's not worrisome. I will not get worried about. What is the significant weight loss? Okay, في عنده unintentional weight loss. I lost weight and I wasn't planning to do so. I just lost weight, although I eat normally. Is it significant or not? How to know that it is it significant or not? If the patient loses more than 5% of his weight in 6 months, يعني if I'm 100 kilos, I lose 5 or let's say 7, more than 5, 7 kilograms in 6 months. Unintentional, without being on a diet, without having extra exercise. This is significant weight loss. Not every weight loss is significant. لازم أعرف شغلتين على weight loss. Intentional, unintentional, and the percentage. Is it significant or insignificant? Okay, dysphagia. Dysphagia is difficulty in swallowing. Don't confuse it with odynophagia. Odynophagia means pain during swallowing. Dysphagia is difficulty during swallowing. Sometimes difficulty is associated with some discomfort, of course, or some mild pain. So dysphagia is the wider or broader term, but it is not pain. If I mean pain during swallowing, I will choose the term odynophagia. Dysphagia is caused by many, many things, actually. We can classify it into localized problem in the esophagus or in the pharynx or systemic problem. We start by the oral cavity, tonsillitis, enlarged tonsils, pharyngitis, painful mouth, ulcers, peritonsillar or pharyngeal abscess will cause dysphagia and odynophagia. Some neurological disorders, okay, like stroke, cerebrovascular accident, if it affects the midbrain, the centers of swallowing. Localized problem like achalasia. Of course, now these are just examples. Later on, when you study surgery in details, we will analyze each one of them. Some mechanical causes like esophageal cancer, esophageal strictures caused by gastroesophageal reflux disease, peptic strictures. Vomiting. Again, vomiting is caused by localized problem or systemic problem. It can be caused by just a drug, a side effect of a medication. It can be caused by increased intracranial pressure. Okay, something away from the GI. ما له أي علاقة. Or as a side effect of a medication. خاصة زي إيش؟ إيش بيعمل vomiting? Drugs. Chemotherapy. Yeah, many, many drugs. Whatever you say will be correct. But I mean something very significant. Chemotherapy. Okay. Also, mechanical obstruction cause vomiting. For example, gastric outlet obstruction, bowel obstruction by any cause, whether dynamic or adynamic, will cause vomiting. Now, we should analyze vomiting. It's not enough to say the patient has vomiting. وأسجلها وخلص. لا. لازم أحكي whether it is projectile or non-projectile. شو يعني projectile؟ يعني بقذفها المريض. It will travel for a distance. Forceful vomiting. Projectile vomiting. Non-projectile, هي regular one. It will go by gravity down. Okay. Projectile vomiting means, not always, but يعني it lets us think of increased intracranial pressure or gastric outlet obstruction. يعني أنا عندي obstruction في البايلورس. عندي, for example, gastric cancer obstructing the pylorus. أو عندي recurrent peptic ulcer disease near the pylorus وصار لها healing وstricture وعملت narrowing of the gastric outlet. أو عندي baby عنده infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Okay, we'll have forceful or projectile vomiting. So projectile vomiting means increased intracranial pressure or gastric outlet obstruction. شو أسباب الgastric outlet obstruction? Infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, peptic ulcer, gastric cancer, whatever. A long list. I should know also that whether the vomitus is bilious or non-bilious. إذا كان bilious معناته أنا عندي the vomitus came from the small bowel. صح؟ البايل وين بيروح على الستومك؟ It goes to the from the second part of the duodenum, ampulla of water, it pours in the second part, then it travels distally. So it means the vomitus came from the small bowel. So if I have, for example, bowel obstruction or GI obstruction in general, and I have recurrent non-bilious vomiting, so mostly the obstruction is proximal to the ampulla of water. If I have bilious vomiting, then the obstruction is distal to the ampulla of water. This is very important in pediatric age group. يعني لما نجيب سؤال, a baby presented in the first day of his life with bilious vomiting. ونكون حاطين من الخيارات infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. طب أنا عارف إنه هاي infantile pyloric stenosis تعمل non-bilious vomiting. وحاطط من another option duodenal atresia. For example, or intestinal atresia in general. This is the correct answer because the obstruction is distal to the ampulla of water. Many other causes, actually, a very long list, even more than the ones mentioned here. This is a very summarized one. Pregnancy will cause vomiting, diabetic ketoacidosis, liver failure, electrolyte disturbances like hypercalcemia, Addison's disease, or Addisonian crisis. اللي هي adrenal acute adrenal insufficiency. It can be induced also, like bulimia nervosa. Okay, abdominal distension. When I describe the abdomen of any patient, I describe it as scaphoid, flat, or distended. This distension can be caused by many things. يعني biologic. شو اللي ممكن يزيد size of the abdomen؟ يعني in more simple form. Yes, you are right. But let's say what can fill the abdomen or what can be the material? Gases can be distended with gases. هلا شو أسباب الغازز؟ Irritable bowel syndrome, bowel obstruction, whatever. I have long list. Gases. أو flatus هنا علشان نتذكرهم عملناهم 5 F's flatus or gases fetus simply pregnant woman her abdomen is distended with gravid uterus or feces واحد عنده constipation old man his colon is loaded with stool عنده abdominal distension أو bowel obstruction أو fecal material fluid it can be filled with fluid in the peritoneal cavity, not inside the lumen of the bowel. Okay, inside the lumen of the bowel, معناته في عندي ممكن bowel obstruction or something like that. لا, ممكن ما عندي bowel obstruction. عندي ascites. Ascites means accumulation of fluid in the peritoneal cavity. أو just simply being fat, يعني adipose tissue filling the abdomen. Why the abdomen is distinct? The patient is fat, simply. Now this table shows causes of ascites. Causes of ascites. We have localized causes and systemic causes. The systemic causes include failures, anything failure, heart failure, renal failure, liver failure. Of course, liver failure follows, for example, long-standing liver cirrhosis, okay? Or long-standing viral hepatitis. Any intra-abdominal malignancy, like pancreatic cancer, gastric cancer, anything, any malignancy in the abdomen may cause ascites. Hypoproteinemia, hypoalbuminemia, whether it is caused by liver disease or by nephrotic syndrome. Did that occur in nephrotic syndrome? Simply, I will not mention details, but simply it is losing proteins from the kidney. Okay? When you lose proteins, the oncotic pressure decreases. So you lose fluid in the peritoneal cavity. Now, liver disease can cause ascites in two ways. كيف؟ عند liver cirrhosis. The liver produces or synthesizes albumin or protein, right? طيب صار عندي hypoalbuminemia. Hypoalbuminemia بدها تعمل لي ascites. Also, liver cirrhosis will cause portal hypertension. Portal hypertension. Portal hypertension by itself will cause ascites. So I have two reasons why I have ascites in liver diseases, chronic liver diseases and liver failure. Okay. Also, among the very, very important associated symptoms of the abdominal complaints are altered bowel habits. Please, please, now concentrate with me. What I will say, I will keep repeating. I will keep repeating. يعني راح أزهقكم بس تيجوا على الجراحة. وراح أذكركم إنه أنا شرحت لكم إياه في الانترودكتوري. واللي راح يجاوب غلط راح يكون يا إما غايب اليوم أو كاين مش مركز. يعني راح يكشف حاله. فبليز concentrate with me. Very important. Before we ask the patient if he has diarrhea or constipation, we must first know the definition of diarrhea and constipation. And we should make sure that the patient understands it the same, or at least we explain it in a different way. So, how do we define diarrhea? Diarrhea is bowel motion with a frequency more than 3 times daily. نركز على frequency, not the consistency. مش loose stool. Passage of loose stool once. Diarrhea. No, this is not diarrhea. Passage of three or of more than 3 bowel motions a day is diarrhea. So it's frequency. طيب, constipation is also defined by frequency. Passage of bowel motion with a frequency less than once every 3 days, this is called constipation. طب هلا راح تحكوا لي طب يا دكتور passage of solid stool isn't it constipation? Passage of watery stool isn't it diarrhea? I will tell you something. Usually consistency follows the frequency. يعني do you expect a person to pass motion once every 5 days وتكون watery أو loose? أكيد تكون solid. So the consistency follows. أو someone passes 7 times bowel motion a day. تتوقع يكون hard stool? Of course no. فيعني هي بتيجي معها. The consistency will follow the frequency. The frequency is more important. Just passing one episode of hard stool It doesn't mean it's constipation. So when you ask the patient, please don't ask, do you have diarrhea or constipation? No, ask it in a different way. What is your usual bowel habit in the last week, last month, whatever? إذا ما فهم عليكو احكوا له. Do you go to bathroom to empty your bowel once a day, twice a day, for example, once every other day, once every 3 days? What is the frequency? ساعتها بفهم. Okay, دكتور. أنا بروح كل يوم. Sometimes in mostly once a day. Sometimes more than once. Depends on the diet. And you know what? Sometimes few days pass without going to bathroom, or يعني every other day. So this is normal. The average is once a day, أكثر أو أقل. Okay, and you ask about the last bowel motion. Last bowel motion. يعني من غير المعقول إنه إحنا نحكي عن حالة acute abdomen, and the student comes to me, presents the history, and says, the patient has abdominal pain for the last 6 hours. Associated with diarrhea. طبعا بعد ما يعمل analysis للبين. Okay. بحكي له طيب associated with diarrhea. امتى بلشت الدياريه؟ قبل البين ولا بعد البين؟ لا دكتور بعد البين. يعني الدياريه بلشت in the last 6 hours او اقل حتى. طب كيف عرفت انها دياريه؟ هي passed loose bowel motion. How many times? Once or twice. طيب. Can I define it as diarrhea until this point? No. Whenever the history is short, I don't expect to apply the term diarrhea or constipation. بينما يجيني واحد عندي chronic abdominal pain for the last 6 months. أو عندي anal pain for the last 6 months. أيوة, okay. What is your bowel habit? Once every week for the last 6 months. Okay, this is constipation. ماشي مع الكومبلينت. Complaint من 6 شهور. والبول هابت altered من 6 شهور. Okay, please keep this in mind. طيب. Now the causes of constipation are very, very many that I cannot mention them all in one lecture. I need 2-3 lectures just to keep talking about headlines in a very summarized way about causes of constipation. Okay? طيب. What is tenesmus? لما نسمع tenesmus, what does it mean? Tenesmus means sensation that you need to defecate and you go to empty your bowel, nothing goes out. Or maybe just some mucus. You expect large amount. You feel that there is a large amount of stool in my rectum. And then I go to empty it, nothing goes out. One drop of mucus, maybe. So this is tenesmus. What are the causes? Irritation of the rectum. Maybe proctitis. Maybe a large polyp in the rectum. Maybe طبعاً proctitis caused by radiation, infectious proctitis, a very long list. Okay, just in a very summarized way. Diarrhea. Acute diarrhea usually caused by gastroenteritis or infection, or as a side effect of a drug. Chronic diarrhea or recurrent diarrhea. Irritable bowel syndrome is a common cause. Inflammatory bowel disease, okay, IBD and IBS, لا تلخبطوا بيناتهم. It can be caused by colorectal cancer, by neuropathy, by excessive use of laxatives, by electrolyte disturbances, by hyperthyroidism, by malabsorption, and celiac disease, lactose intolerance. Constipation, as we said, long list, but the commonest is behavioral. يعني my diet, يعني diet poor in fibers, diet with very low amount of water, okay, sedentary lifestyle, يعني واحد ما بتحركش من المكتب للسيارة للبيت, ما في exercise, sedentary lifestyle, okay. In surgery, when we say constipation, we think of the surgical causes. The commonest is bowel obstruction. Bowel obstruction. Okay. Now we will talk about bleeding from the GI tract. We should be precise in the terminology. Hematemesis means vomiting blood. This blood can be fresh blood, bright red blood, or it can be altered. شو يعني؟ And the blood stays some time in the stomach, so it will be altered by the digestive enzymes and by the acidity. So it becomes like the coffee ground. When you drink coffee, I assume that many of you are coffee drinkers. شوفوا الكوفي جراوند كيف حث للقهوة اللي بالقاع بس تشرب اللي بضل هاد. Okay, it's very similar. Looks very similar to the altered blood in the stomach. So coffee ground vomiting means there is bleeding in the upper GI, which is not very recent. يعني it took some time. The bleeding is not going on right now. Hematochezia means bleeding that passes through the rectum. لما أحكي أنا bleeding per rectum تختلف عن rectal bleeding. And even in some books you will find the term rectal bleeding. But when we say rectal bleeding or vaginal bleeding, it means that the bleeding comes from this organ. Rectal bleeding means the rectum itself is bleeding. Vaginal bleeding means the blood, the vagina itself is bleeding. But to be more accurate, we say bleeding per rectum or through the rectum, that it passes through the rectum. From where it came, I don't know. Somewhere, but it passed through the rectum. It means the blood that I see coming out of the anus, okay? Bleeding per rectum. Also, melena. What does melena mean? Melena means bleeding usually in the upper GI. The blood passes the whole GI tract and is and or was exposed to digestive enzymes. So it gets altered. It becomes black, black tarry. Tarry يعني زي الزفتة. زي الزفتة السخنة عشان ما عمركم تنسوا التشبيه. Black, tarry, sticky, very foul smelling stool. But when you ask the patient about the smell, he will tell you, of course, you are asking me about stool. Of course it will have bad smell. But tell him, no. Was the smell so bad, very bad, that you memorized it? Not the same smell of the regular stool. Okay? يعني كيف تحكي للمريض؟ طيب هل عمرك أخرجت كان لون الدم أسود وهيك ستيكي ولوس والسمل يعني عبت البيت كله كانت very bad يعني it was a really a bad experience. Okay, this is the best description of melena. هلا ليش طيب ليش يعني أنا I give you these disgusting details. Why? Because they are very important. Not every black stool is melena. ممكن يكون عندي أنا black stool caused by simply iron supplements. خاصة الفيميلز عندها iron deficiency تأخذ حبوب حديد. طيب how to describe the stool? Solid and black. Smell is very light. Is this melena? No, this is not melena. أو I have ingested, for example, large amounts of spinach or any diet, any food that has dark dyes or colors. Okay, it will cause black discoloration of the stool. Is it melena? No. Melena is black, tarry, sticky, very foul smelling stool caused by bleeding in the upper GI and the blood gets altered, digested all the way لحد ما يوصل لتحت بيكون altered. طيب لو عندي أنا fresh bleeding through the rectum, can it be from the upper GI? It can be, why not? It depends on the rate of flow. If the bleeding is with high flow, So it passes, the transit time is very short. It passes quickly down, presents as bright red. أحد أشهر الأمثلة عليها aorto enteric fistula or aorto duodenal fistula, a fistula between the for example abdominal aortic aneurysm and the duodenum. يعني تخيلوا الفلو الأورطة فتح على الدودينم حنفية large amount of blood, so it can pass down and present as upper GI bleeding. Okay, common causes of upper GI bleeding, the commonest is peptic ulcer disease, gastric or duodenal ulcer, mallory waste, esophageal tears, esophagitis, gastritis, duodenitis. Actually, gastritis and duodenitis are part of the peptic ulcer disease. يعني الألسر ما بتبلش على طول هيك. ببلش gastritis, duodenitis, then it will progress to erosions, gastric erosions, and then the erosions will grow deeper to become ulcers. Vascular malformations, esophageal varices in patients with portal hypertension, gastric cancer, esophageal cancer. Causes of, أنا ليش حكيت لكم شو مكتوب؟ rectal bleeding, but please don't use it. يعني مكتوبي هون بس to be more accurate, use bleeding per rectum. Okay. Bleeding per rectum caused by anything. Colon cancer, angiodysplasia, diverticulosis, hemorrhoids simply, and anal fissures. Inflammatory bowel disease, especially ulcerative colitis. Jaundice is also a very common associated symptom. It is defined as yellowish discoloration of the sclera and skin and the mucous membrane. Why we mention the sclera? Because it's the first site where the discoloration occurs. يعني ممكن انت تشوف مريض with discoloration of the sclera but the skin looks normal. Okay, first it appears in the sclera, then in the skin, usually from up down, head or face, trunk, and then goes to the limbs. Okay, jaundice or hyperbilirubinemia, we should classify it also according to the type, whether it is conjugated or unconjugated. Now, in surgery, we use another term. We use direct and indirect. شو يعني direct و indirect? Direct means conjugated. Indirect, unconjugated. Why it is important? يعني when we give details, it's not just to annoy you to study more, but because it is really significant. Direct hyperbilirubinemia has different list of causes. يعني أنا شفت مريض جوندست فحصلت له البيليروبين عنده التوتال بيليروبين very high. I should go and look to the direct bilirubin. If the total bilirubin is 5 and the direct is 4 or 4.5, it means the increment is caused by the direct or the conjugated bilirubin. So I will start thinking of the list of causes تبعت direct hyperbilirubinemia. Okay? In surgery, we are more concerned about direct hyperbilirubinemia. Why? Because the causes are surgical. طيب نبلش بال indirect. Indirect hyperbilirubinemia. Causes, the most common is hemolysis. Hemolysis. هلا شو hemolysis؟ عندي spherocytosis, sickle cell, anemia, عندي glucose 6 phosphate, dehydrogenase, all these causes of hemolysis. Blood transfusion reaction, incompatibility, any hemolysis will cause indirect hyperbilirubinemia. The total bilirubin بيكون high with direct low. معناته أنا بستنتج إنه الزيادة في ال indirect. طيب. Direct hyperbilirubinemia is caused by obstruction in the biliary system. For example, stone obstructing the common bile duct. Okay? Pancreatic head tumor or periampullary tumor obstructing the lower part of the common bile duct. Biliary strictures, cholangiocarcinoma, anything. Liver diseases usually cause mixed picture, يعني بيكون direct to indirect. Direct أكثر شوي, بس usually it is mixed. Okay, other symptoms, حكينا abdominal pain, we analyzed the pain, we talked about vomiting, nausea, weight loss, altered bowel motion, diarrhea, constipation, dysphagia, okay, abdominal distension. Now, other less common symptoms, painful mouth ulcers or pain in the mouth. Usually, pathologies in the tongue and the angles of the mouth are caused by vitamin deficiency, iron deficiency, vitamin B12 or folate deficiency, vitamin C deficiency. Sometimes it is associated with like Behçet disease, will be associated with mouth ulcers, inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's disease. Okay. As we said, odynophagia is pain during swallowing, and dysphagia is difficulty in swallowing. طيب في term اسمه dyspepsia. Dyspepsia is a very vague term. Actually, I personally I don't prefer to use it. Dyspepsia doesn't mean something specific. It can be understood as pain, discomfort, indigestion, some nausea, some bloating, some, it's a mixture of symptoms in the upper abdomen or in the proximal GI. Try as much as you can to avoid using this term, dyspepsia, okay? Now we finished, luckily, not very late, we finished the first part about the history. بدكو بريك ولا بدكوش؟ Okay, 10 minutes break, please, or 15 minutes. 15 minutes we start.